lecture series. Tonight's guest is one half of the mischievous and subversive culture jamming activist duo, the Yes Men. Their latest feature film, The Yes Men Are Revolting, is out now. Please welcome to the stage Yes Man, Andy Bichlbaum.
Thanks to everyone who made this possible. Jeff Burgess, Ben Soman, the mysterious Ben Soman, who knows where he is, and everybody else. This is really amazing to be here, and it's been really exciting and interesting. I'm going to tell some stories, and probably more or less like I usually tell them, but I was thinking through how I might tell them, and realized that actually the usual way I tell them is kind of pretty appropriate. Anyways, I'll just get started and tell some stories for a little while, and if you have any questions in the middle, feel free to raise your hand. I'll pause at a given place after about 15 minutes anyways and take questions, and then we can just move forward as we see fit, and I've got lots of videos, and we can just talk sort of free form. And I'd really like this to be useful to you and anything that you care about. So if there's an issue that you're involved in, if there's an activist group you're involved with, if there's something you are already fighting around politically or that you've thought about fighting around politically, try to, you know, I hope some of this is useful for that. Regardless of whether what I talk about is, here are some resources that I find really useful. And I'll flash them up again and talk about them later, but especially the first three. The fourth is just a plug for our website. But yeah, we'll get into that. Yay, plug. All right, so first I'll tell a little bit about my story. This is an office.
No way.
Yeah, it's not... It's not the office I used to work in, but it's a typical office, and it's extremely boring looking. I found myself working in one of these as a temp after a lot of college and a lot of graduate school. I went to university at the University of Arizona and studied for about 6 years because I couldn't make my mind up what I wanted to do. I was interested in pretty much everything, and I didn't know how to focus into one thing and just decide, I'm going to do that and not anything else. So I ended up getting two majors, a bunch of minors, and then graduated with no idea what I wanted to do. So I went to graduate school for creative writing, which is what people who don't know what they want to do. And wrote short fiction and ended up publishing a couple of books. But then I still, well, they didn't make any money. I mean, books of short fiction don't make money, generally. And I had to make a living out of graduate school. And so I ended up in a place like this as a temp. And so I had already discovered one of my big flaws was being unable to decide what to do. And it was in an office like this that I discovered what turned out to be my biggest strength, which was a sense of mischief. And I had never thought of it as a strength until I was in an office like this working as a temp, and I realized I was kind of interested in the thing on the desk that I was entering data into, the computer, and it just kind of naturally occurred to me that I should just try to pretend I knew something about it. First, of course, I had to actually learn a little bit about it, so I talked to one of the programmers at the office, and he lent me a manual and gave me a few pointers on how to figure it out. And once I had a bare level of competence and could sort of play with the thing, I forged a resume and landed a job as a senior programmer in the language I had kind of gotten a passing acquaintance with. And that actually went pretty well. It turns out there isn't a huge level of competence in the world. So if you have enthusiasm, that more than makes up for whatever you may lack. And so I was a senior programmer at a job doing database programming. It was a horrible insurance company. But I did that for 3 months and then quit and got another job. I can't even remember what that one was. But I went through a few of these jobs as a database programmer, basically. And eventually, I realized there was probably more to computers than that. And, well, I knew there was more to computers than that. And so I started learning at a bank. I was at a bank at this point doing database programming. And I started learning C++ and did basically the same thing. Talked to one of the programmers who was very helpful because they really, you know, they're a bit lonely. They like to talk to people. And he gave me a lot of pointers on how to become better at programming and learn this language, C++. I picked it up, forged a resume, and landed a job as one of the first two programmers on The Sims at Maxis. It was then called Maxis. It became Electronic Arts. Yeah. Thank you. That applause is for my resume faking skills. But it turned out I was not bad at programming, and ended up for about 6 months. I worked on a prototype of The Sims, which was called at the time Project X, and I developed little behavior trees for the little people, and developed a little skeleton editor for the little people, so I could make these little people run around and do primitive behaviors, and then they transferred me to another game. Called SimCopter, which was not a very interesting game. And this came at a really bad time. It came at a time when I had never lasted at a job longer than about 6 months, so they transferred me to this at about the lifespan of my usual job. And my boyfriend at the time after about a month working on this game, he broke up with me, and I needed time off. And unfortunately, the game had to make it to market really fast. So I was frustrated, and they wouldn't give me time off to deal with that, because that's not how the business world seemed to work. And I was pretty frustrated with the whole thing. So I decided, instead of just quitting, which I was inclined to do, I decided I would leave the job in an interesting way. And since I was in charge of the code, I could make it do anything I wanted. And nobody would ever read through the code, ever. So I, just before the game was set to be produced and shipped to store shelves, I put a little bit of code in that randomly made it so that the entire screen would be filled with guys in swimsuits kissing each other madly, and also kissing the little pilot avatar that you were steering around in the game, trying to, you know, rescue people and do all the nonsense that you had to do. That was me. What, you've heard of this? Okay, that was me. Yeah. It was set to happen fairly randomly, very, very rarely, but especially on my ex-boyfriend's birthday, and I think on Friday the 13th. But
did he ever play the game?
Did I?
No, your ex-boyfriend.
No. No, he didn't play computer games. But he found out about it, and I'll tell you why. The day after the game was produced and shipped to store shelves, like 80,000 copies were produced and shipped. And the morning after, my boss, the guy who had invented this whole game and the inventor of The Sims, Will Wright, was playing the game with his 9-year-old daughter, and he got to the final level of the game, and boom, the entire screen was covered in kissing boys, kissing each other, and his 9-year-old daughter, and it was, he was a little bit surprised and maybe annoyed, but he was very diplomatic the next day. He just said, you know, you should have told us. You should have told us you were going to do that. And I said, but you wouldn't have let me do it. So how, you know, why would I have told you? So so I was fired after about a week. And I started telling people about this story, and you know, I wasn't traumatized by being fired. It was sort of the object of the game. And but I was telling various people about it, and among the people I told about it was this one friend in San Francisco who's a journalist named Steve Silberman, which some of you may recognize that name because he just wrote an amazing book called Neurotribes that I saw is scheduled for a reading group April 29th, apparently. April 29th. Thank you, voice in the back. And so Steve, I was telling Steve about it, and he said, that's amazing. I'm going to write an article about it. And so that's what he did. He wrote an article. This isn't the article he wrote. This was afterwards. But he wrote it for Wired magazine. And he asked me why I had done it. And I said, well, I don't know. My boyfriend broke up with me. I was sick of the job. And he said, well, wasn't there something about that game that bugged you? And I said, well, yeah, it was kind of macho. And so he made this article be a little bit about being opposed to macho content in video games and, you know, wanting to get an LGBT voice in to video games, which, you know, I completely agreed with. I might have done it differently if I had thought of it as a political action, but it quickly became a political action afterwards. And it was... So after his article was published, the AP was interested, television was interested, there was a ton of press about this, and I was very excited about all this. This is a little snippet of the television coverage. Let's see. And that's... what they looked like. Not particularly impressive little stick figures, but that's what it looked like in the late 90s. If we can raise the volume a little bit on that for the next one. Oh. Okay, we already heard that. So I was pretty excited about this... the amount of press that was coming out of this. And I think I was primed for that because of what was going on in San Francisco at the time. I was living in San Francisco, and this was during the period of ACT UP, which was an incredible movement, which ended up succeeding in forcing the government and pharmaceutical companies to actually do research into AIDS treatments, which is why a lot fewer people have died of AIDS than would have if they hadn't. But they used a lot of mischievous techniques and did a lot of really crazy things, including at one point they covered a homophobic senator's house in a giant condom. Jesse Helms's house in a... No way, which friend? Yeah. I've met him. He's one of the tag guys. Oh, okay. Yeah. yeah, that's amazing. I've never met anybody who knew one of them. But yeah, they covered his house with a giant condom that said, Helms is the plague, you know, it's bad policies that kill, and so on. And it got a ton of TV coverage, of course, but...
Where did they get the giant condom?
From Greenpeace. Yeah. They were, of course. I mean, who else has giant condoms lying around? No, they built it, but it's not hard to build a giant condom, it turns out. They climbed to the top, unrolled it. It just, you know, it was like a banner hang, basically. It was like one of those Greenpeace banner hangs, except it was a condom. And, you know, they were doing all kinds of stuff like that at the time. And so I was... just kind of primed, I think of mischief as a way to get attention for an activist issue. And when I found that I had accidentally done that, I was hooked. And there's a lot to the story I'm going to skip over, including this little video, which will make no sense. Just want to get to... Okay. I basically started doing... trying to think of ways to do this some more. Because I was hooked. I enjoyed it. I enjoyed the media attention. I enjoyed the politics of it. And a couple of friends, I was telling people about this, and a couple of friends connected me with a fellow named Mike, the other Yes Man, who had done a sort of similar action, much more on purpose, where he had taken talking Barbie dolls and talking G.I. Joe dolls that both said very sexist things, and he switched their voice boxes and put them back on store shelves so that, you know, the Barbies said kill, kill, kill or whatever, and the G.I. Joes said come shopping or math is hard. And that got a ton of attention back in 1994. And so we started working together and coming up with, you know, various projects and playing around and enjoying ourselves with mischief and politics and seeing what could happen. And trying to make it useful in some way, you know, not just mischief for mischief's sake, but trying to make it useful. That was kind of our basic guideline. And in the middle of this, in 1999, suddenly this movement that had been global, except for the US, suddenly erupted in the US, the anti-globalization movement. And you've probably heard of Seattle, the Battle of Seattle. 30,000 protesters headed to Seattle, which isn't a huge number, but it was enough to shut down the WTO's meeting there in 1999. And the WTO, the World Trade Organization, was sort of the body in charge of, their mandate was to allow corporations to do what they wanted without interference from national governments. To grossly oversimplify it, that's basically what they were about. And so they became the focus of a movement, the anti-globalization movement, that was against that sort of philosophy, the philosophy of letting the market decide what to do, no matter what the consequences. Believe it or not, the idea of letting the market do whatever it wants had become really mainstream in the US since the late 70s. And the basic idea of it was you let the rich do whatever they want, you let money do whatever it wants, big corporations do whatever they want, things work out great for everyone. And it took a little while for people to recognize not only the idiocy of that, but the horror of what resulted. And this movement in 1999 was sort of the big eruption of opposition to that. And so Mike and I, we were at the time playing around with websites because it was the late 90s. And the web had been invented in 1994, so there weren't very many people doing a lot of what we now take for granted with websites. There weren't a lot of fake websites out there. We started playing around with fake websites. This is a fake Shell Oil website that we just threw up just for the fun of it. And when people started heading to Seattle, I mean, not just for the fun of it, there was also a point, there was a lot of anger at Shell for something bad that they did back then. But when people started focusing on the World Trade Organization and heading to Seattle to shut it down, we wanted to participate somehow, and we couldn't actually make it to Seattle, so we threw up a fake website instead. And it looked just like the real World Trade Organization website, but it had a lot of satirical content that made a lot of fun of World Trade Organization policies while pretending to represent them. And so it was basically just a parody website. It was the best we could do. It wasn't much. But one amazing thing that happened was that the World Trade Organization, the real one, actually noticed our website and wrote a press release attacking it. And this was at the time when 30,000 people were headed to shut them down. They decided to write a press release about our website. And because there is no WTO transparency and nobody could actually find the press release on their website, nobody noticed. So they wrote, the head of PR for the WTO wrote us an email, an angry email saying, look what you made us do. You made us write this press release attacking you. And we were so appalled. We were really horrified. So we sent their press release to thousands and thousands of journalists on our email list. And as a result, we got this sort of thing. We got articles mentioning our website and us and what we were doing and the whole protest. And because of that, you see, there would be like, you'd have a line, and there were a bunch of these articles, and in the article there would be our URL, which is gatt.org. G-A-T-T was the old initials for the WTO, so people sometimes made the mistake. And you'd have WTO in the same sentence. And because of that, search engines, which weren't as sophisticated as they are now, would pick up our website as having something to do with the WTO. And so we started getting a lot of email intended for the WTO from just random people on the internet. Like, you know, one person from the Isle of Man, Treasury Department asked us, you know, what the relationship of Gibraltar, whatever that is, was to the WTO. And we just wrote back. We just really wrote back about, you know, basically using the idea that you shouldn't question these things too much. And, you know, if you just accept that you let the rich do whatever they want, things will work out great for everyone, that's the basis of it all, we would just run with it. as I mentioned, I wrote... Yeah, exactly. So my creative writing background came in handy. And we actually have like a full book of this, of these emails that we haven't published. Don't know what to do with them. They're like this. You can't really read them. Then one day, we got a really different kind of email. We got this. And this was a legal conference in Salzburg, Austria, who wanted the director general of the WTO to come speak at their conference. And his name happened to be Mike Moore. And he happened to be kind of large. And so, I mean, the first thing we did when we got this email was kind of sit on it. We had no idea what to do. We were just like, wow, somebody actually invited us to a conference, or invited the director general of the WTO to a conference, thinking that he was with us, with our website. And so we just sat on it for a while. And then after about a month, we had the idea, well, let's forward it to Michael Moore, the one we know. And so we did, and no answer. And then another month went by, and it finally occurred to us that we could actually go. And so we, at that point, quickly, after 2 months, wrote back and said, oh yes, absolutely. Unfortunately, Director General Moore can't make it, but he will send a substitute. He would be delighted to, and we're gonna, you know, have a really, we're gonna just treat this with the utmost seriousness, and yes, thank you for thinking of us. And so they were astounded that the WTO would pay attention to their little conference, and we went and delivered a talk in Austria. And we decided to make it as offensive as we possibly could. And we brought along a friend with a camera who sat at the back, to sit at the back of the room and film everything so that when chaos erupted, he would catch it on film. And we'd have a funny little video to share with the world to prove that it had happened. And so the talk we prepared went through a lot of this and that, insulted Italians for being lazy and praised Dutch people for working so hard, and, you know, talked about eliminating all national customs as impediments to trade and impediments to commerce, and all this sort of stuff, and then got to the pièce de résistance, which was talking about the main problem for commerce and the main problem for capitalism, which was democracy. Because, you know, people can vote any which way. And when you, this is an actual slide from the presentation. When you go through the usual way, you have campaigns like, first you have corporations that fund campaigns, and then the campaigns have to fund PR agencies to produce all kinds of ads for TV stations, which then show these ads to voters. And the green is transfer of money, so there's a lot of money going, except at the end, where the TV station shows to the voters. And then the voters can do whatever they want, so it's chaos. Instead, why not just have corporations fund voters directly through a website and just pay people to vote for whoever they want? That would dramatically simplify the whole thing. It would be much more efficient, save a lot of money, save a lot of effort, and come up with better outcomes to elections in general. And we even had a mock-up of the website. And so, you know, here I am at the podium pretending to be this guy from the WTO giving this talk, and pretty sure there's going to be a really heinous, nasty reaction, and we're going to end up in an Austrian jail, but the guy in the back pretending to be a journalist would catch it on film and we'd have a funny video. But instead, people just sat there, asked polite questions, and we went to lunch with them and had a whole conversation in which, during that conversation, I talked about how the Nazis had enlightened trade policies and nothing, no reaction whatsoever. We had to eventually announce, we got all the emails of all the conference participants, so we had to send an email to all the conference participants once we were back in the States saying that the speaker from the WTO had been hit in the face with a pie for saying something really nasty outside during the conference. And this pie had contained a toxin, and so he was on his deathbed. And it was really important that people remember what he had said. Was it, you know, what had he said? And people wrote back with great consternation and concern about me lying on my deathbed. But the things they didn't remember anything offensive that I had said. Like, there was nothing offensive about my talk. So we ended up making a video about that, and it took a lot of effort. And the New York Times published the whole correspondence with the delegates to the conference about this, and it ended up being a big job to go through all this. And because the New York Times had published all this stuff, we thought, well, that's over. That was fun. It was interesting. But we kept getting email at our fake website, including very shortly afterwards, another email inviting us to a conference, inviting the WTO to a conference in Finland. This was a textiles conference at a university. So this time we decided we would not just tell people and show slides because that apparently didn't arouse enough of a reaction. This time we would actually make something visual and show them what we were trying to say. Like, make a giant prop that would illustrate what we were trying to say in a kind of satirical way. So we prepared this talk about the WTO's solution to remote labor, to the problem of, like, locating factories far away to produce cheaper and cheaper goods, race to the bottom, treating workers less and less fairly, you know, taking away American jobs, all that. Basically casting that as a really good thing, except for one problem, which is that somebody has to manage those workers, and what American CEO really wants to go live in Bangladesh? Nobody. So this was our textile solution from the World Trade Organization for this that we presented at a conference in Tampere, Finland. And I'll show you a little excerpt.
In a world where the headquarters of a company might be in New York, Hong Kong, or Espoo, Finland, and the workers are in Gabon, Rangoon, or Estonia, How does a manager maintain proper rapport with the workers? And how does he or she ensure from a distance that workers perform their work in an ethical fashion? I'm about to show you an actual prototype of the WTO solution to two major management problems of today. Now, we all know that not even the best workplace design can help even the most astute manager keep track of workers. What you need is a solution that enables complete rapport with workers, especially when they're located far away. Mike, would you help me a moment? Thank you. This is much better, much more comfortable. This is the WTO's answer to two of the major management problems, and we're calling it the management leisure suit. It's the two problems again: how to maintain close rapport with distant workers, and how to remain comfortable and increase leisure activities. How does the management leisure suit work, besides being extremely comfortable, as I can guarantee you? Well, allow me to describe the suit's core features. Physically sensing what's going on in the workforce on the floor through channels implanted directly into the manager. Again, the manager sees the employees, but also feels what they're feeling and can select where to focus in the workplace environment. So, in conclusion, I'd like to ask, is this a science fiction scenario? The answer is no. Everything we've seen here, everything we've been talking about, is entirely possible today. We can always look forward on the highways of progress towards ever new horizons with cooperation and mutual delight in the fruits of prosperity. I'm very excited to be here. Thank you very much.
And so he asks for questions from the audience, and there are none. And in fact, we went to dinner afterwards, a big ceremonial dinner where I was seated opposite the president of the conference's daughter because it was the guest of honor. And nothing. No reaction. And in fact, the next day, not that. Right after the conference, this appeared in the newspaper. And I don't read Finnish, and nobody I know does, but I've been told that this just says the WTO has a new solution for remote labor, and here it is. So... so... This as you may have guessed, that wasn't our camera shooting it. When we got that second invitation to a conference, we decided to connect with an actual filmmaker who knew what he was doing. And they followed us around for about 3 years, and we did various things. About four similar actions in the film, and the result was this beautiful DVD called The Yes Men from MGM. And that was at a period when Michael Moore had just released Bowling for Columbine, so movie companies were very excited about documentaries, so they bought this movie. And it involved, like, as I said, about four or five actions. Three or four of them were basically satirical, like that. They were making fun of the WTO's policies by slightly exaggerating them or making them a little more visual than they usually were. In the final action, we had to finish the film, and we couldn't just do something even crazier than we had already done. So we decided to just take a completely different tack. We were invited by an accounting conference in Australia, who, like everybody else, mistook us for the WTO and invited us to a conference. And we decided there to announce that the WTO was disbanding. And we were going to stop privileging corporate money and stop trying to figure out how to make things great for business, and instead refound as an organization that would try to make business work for humanity. And this, you know, it was a 40-minute talk in which I reeled off all the statistics of how commerce has failed the poor and how it's increased inequality and how, and then talked about how we could refound as an organization to harness business and harness the market and be, you know, do it in a much more careful way rather than the usual way of just letting business do what it wants. And we were really thrilled when the audience was actually thrilled. These were accountants, and we didn't really think that they would be thrilled. We thought they would go along with it, like all the other audiences had gone along with our horrible proposals. But instead, these accountants were actually incredibly enthusiastic, and they gave us all kinds of suggestions for how to make this new organization work, and all the things we could do better than we had, and they drew a logo. They suggested moving the headquarters from Geneva, one of the most expensive cities on earth, to a place where the poorest countries could afford to have an office, and so on and so forth. So that was a lovely conclusion to our movie, and maybe I'll pause for any questions so far before talking about the next thing. Yeah.
So there's some awesome stuff that you presented here, but I wanted to ask, did you get that rated by the MPAA, the Yes Book?
I think so, yeah.
Do you know what it was rated?
Yeah, it was rated R because of swear words.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, there were a bunch of swear words.
So because it was rated, does that mean that it was eligible to be shown in theaters?
Mm-hmm. It was shown in theaters, yeah.
It was, okay, I didn't see it.
Well, this was 2003, so, yeah.
Right, I was 17, I guess. No, well, did you ever see that documentary, This Film Has Not Been Rated? It talks about the MPAA and their kind of diabolical practices. I was just thinking they would be very much in the vein of you fighting against political corruption and social injustice to release this kind of thing DRM-free.
Well,
and without going through the FDA.
Yeah, we did do that with the next movie, which I'll get to.
Okay.
Yeah. And we'll get to a little bit of brainstorming where maybe if you have a pet issue like that, we can talk about how some of these techniques can be useful and so on. So, thanks. Any other questions about this so far?
There were.
Oh.
Yeah.
Hi.
Hey.
Yes. I wanted to know, given the nature of satire and how it can backfire, did you feel as though did you have any regrets, I guess, in terms of, because I guess cognitively with satire, sometimes people tend to
Okay.
So I was thinking, like,
yeah,
is that why you decided to end it with, you know, being actually forthcoming about what you were feeling about, you know, like breaking the stick, like Colbert or Stewart, when they sometimes have to break the stick because ultimately they have to get the point across.
Mm-hmm.
Did everybody hear the question?
Yep.
Fine. Or way over there? I'll repeat it. The question was, since satire can backfire, or I'm just going to use your terms, because people don't get that it's satire, is that why we chose to do it differently at the end, with the other thing where we took this non-satirical approach with the last action? And the answer is no, but we don't think that it backfired, really, by people not getting it. Ultimately, I mean, at first we did. At first we were kind of disappointed, like, what? We went to all this trouble to, you know, wake you guys up, and you don't even notice, and it just felt like, oh, what was that for? But of course, there was a camera there, and the real audience was not the people in the room. They ended up being actors, you know, unwitting actors in our drama that we had written to include them rudely without telling them. And so it, you know, it ended up being the device for us, and it actually was great. And we would toe this line where we'd try to come up with the most obnoxious, horrifying thing we could that would just fall just a hair short of tipping them off and outraging everybody. So the reason we did something different at the end of this film was more just to not do the same thing again, because we need it, you know. And on a certain level, we were just making a film, even though we were doing it in a very strange backwards way. We were just making a film, and we needed something at the end that would be uplifting instead of just showing people falling for it again. We needed something really uplifting, and we were hoping they would react positively to this, but we didn't know how positively they would react to it. So that's initially why we chose a sort of more honest, like, you know, not honest, but an optimistic, positive approach to that. But that's a good segue to the next thing I wanted to show, which was as we kept working after that, we ended up being contacted by some organizations that wanted us to use these kinds of techniques and wanted us to focus on their issue. And the first one was Greenpeace, which was focusing on the Bhopal catastrophe. This was in 2002, they wrote to us. In 2001, let me start at the beginning. 1984 was the Bhopal catastrophe. It was the worst industrial disaster in history, caused by an American company, Union Carbide, which had a chemical plant located in Bhopal, India, which sprang a leak, poorly maintained, a lot of flaws, very predictable that this would happen, and it happened and killed like 3,000 people in one night. 20,000 people over the years died of causes related to that. And the site was never cleaned up. And the survivors were compensated something like $500 each. So in 2001, a much wealthier company bought Union Carbide, which was failing. And that company was named Dow. And Greenpeace wanted to associate public awareness of the Bhopal catastrophe with the name Dow. They wanted to let everybody know that Dow Chemical was actually responsible for the Bhopal catastrophe now and should take measures to clean up the site, compensate the survivors, and so on and so forth. And so they approached us. One fellow at Greenpeace wrote to us and said, would you guys want to try doing this funny thing you've been doing with the World Trade Organization against Dow? And see what happens. And we said, sure, let's try it. So we set up a fake website, which was pretty much all we knew how to do. And we, this is from our second movie, which sort of centers around this, but this is perhaps obviously a restaging of us making a website. we created a fake website at dow-chemical.com, I think it was, and then sent out a press release, this was in 2002, from Dow, announcing that we, Dow, would never take responsibility for the Bhopal catastrophe because the Bhopalis would never be shareholders, and so why should we care? And that is actually pretty accurate. And it was still early enough in the history of the web that making a fake website was still somewhat interesting to the media. And so the New York Times wrote a little article about it, and it got a little bit of attention, and basically the same thing happened as with the WTO site. It got into search engines. People searching on Dow would sometimes stumble on our fake website instead. And 2 years later, in 2004, sometime in late November 2004, a researcher for the BBC who was preparing a broadcast on the 20th anniversary of the Bhopal catastrophe, this was 2004, accidentally contacted us and asked if Dow Chemical might have any comment about all the protesters who were outraged about Dow refusing responsibility for this. And the BBC researcher was quite shocked when he received an email reply saying, yes, absolutely, we would love to talk about this. And we had no idea what we would say, but we knew we wanted to do it. And so we quickly went back to our collaborators at Greenpeace and said, you guys, this thing that you made us do, we're in deep trouble now. We just got an email from the BBC. They want us, thinking we're Dow, to say something on the 20th anniversary. What should we say? And this is where we had the big question, and this comes back to your question about satire versus a different approach. We could have gotten up on the BBC and said, Bhopalis will never be shareholders, why should we care, and blah, blah, blah. And it would have gotten, we felt like that would have gotten a little blip of press. But we figured a different approach might be more interesting and might result in less predictable results, might have some less predictable results and a little more chaos. So we agonized for about a week. Fortunately, that's all we had, because otherwise we would have agonized for months and months. So we agonized for 1 week, and then this happened. And this is an excerpt from the second movie, The Yes Men Fix the World, which is released for free on YouTube. I mean, against our distributor's wishes initially, but they went out of business, so it doesn't matter. All right. I should mention, this is in Paris. So when they wrote, we wrote back and said, yes, we would love to say something. But I happened to be living in Paris at the time. And so we asked if the Dow representative could speak at the BBC office in Paris. Because for one thing, we figured it would be much smaller than the one in London. And as you'll see, it was very, very small indeed. In fact, there was one employee. And the filming actually took place in a broom closet, basically. I mean, there were brooms in the studio, so I don't know if you see them in this, but here it is.
When we acquired Union Carbide 3 years ago, we knew what we were getting, and today we are prepared to do the obvious. Let's see. Don't film too much when we get there, I think. And you're watching BBC World? Our main headlines. The world's worst industrial accident is being remembered in India today. It's 20 years since deadly gas leaked from the Union Carbide chemical plant in the city of Bhopal. At least 18,000 deaths are attributed to the leak. Yes. And many local people say that contamination has never been properly cleared up.
Yeah. Should I typically just look right into the camera?
The factory still exists here, and that's been a real problem for the people living here locally. Many of them some lost members of their family, and they say that they're continuing to suffer because of the tragedy. And they're saying somebody needs to answer for this. Legally, what they're saying is that they want to pursue the company to try and clean up the site, but whether the company will accept liability seems doubtful.
Well, joining us live from Paris now is Jude Ventura. He's a spokesman for Dow Chemicals, which took over Union Carbide. Good morning to you. A day of commemoration in Bhopal. Do you now accept responsibility for what happened?
Steve, yes. Today is a great day for all of us at Dow, and I think for millions of people around the world as well. It's 20 years since the disaster. And today, I'm very, very happy to announce that for the first time, Dow is accepting full responsibility for the Bhopal catastrophe. We have a $12 billion plan to finally, at long last, fully compensate the victims, including the 120,000 who may need medical care for their entire lives, and to fully and swiftly remediate the Bhopal plant site. Now, when we acquired Union Carbide 3 years ago, we knew what we were getting. And it's worth $12 billion. $12 billion. We have resolved to liquidate Union Carbide, this nightmare for the world and this headache for Dow, and use the $12 billion to adequately compensate the victims.
Jude, that's good news that you have finally accepted responsibility. Some people would say too late, it's 3 years, almost 4 years on.
When we acquired Union Carbide, we did settle their liabilities in the United States immediately. And we are now, 3 years later, prepared to do the same in India. We should have done it 3 years ago, we are doing it now. And I would also like to say that this is no small matter, Steve. This is the first time in history that a publicly owned company of anything near the size of Dow has performed an action which is significantly against its bottom line simply because it's the right thing to do. And our shareholders may take a bit of a hit, Steve, but I think that if they're anything like me, they will be ecstatic to be part of such a historic occasion of doing right by those that we've wronged.
Just to reiterate what Jude Ventura, the spokesman for Dow Chemicals, has just said, he says that Dow Chemicals now fully accept responsibility for the events in Bhopal.
Great, that's it. Great. Now they want radio. I can tell you one thing. We're not going out of business. We will continue to make profit. We will simply make slightly less profit than normal. But we are doing the right thing. We're comparing here, though, the value of money to the value of human life, and there is no comparison. Exactly. I mean, how often does Dow get to be, you know? It wouldn't be, I wouldn't want to be a Dow spokesperson otherwise. Oh my God. Oh my God.
Oh. Sorry.
What did Dow do after that?
Well, the first thing Dow did was lose about $2 billion on the stock market. which, you know, if you think about it, that kind of illustrates why companies don't do the right thing. It's because, you know, and why you have to legislate for companies to do things. Because no company ever is going to do that kind of a thing. Because if they had really done it, then their stock value wouldn't have just lost $2 billion, it would have lost a lot more, and whoever had made that decision would be fired and who knows what else. As it was, it lost $2 billion, and then as soon as it was announced to be a hoax, about 1 hour later, the stock value came right back up. Sadly. And then, of course, the other thing Dow did was issue a very terse announcement, their little paragraph announcement about why they're not responsible for the Bhopal catastrophe. And that was very disappointing for us. And so we helped them out a little bit with a much longer attack on ourselves that we just kind of concocted at the moment, saying all the reasons we would not actually do this, and nobody should worry about us ever doing the right thing in Bhopal. And to this day, people still think that was a real press release, unfortunately. Generally, when we do these things, we make a point of revealing the hoax afterwards and making sure there's no trace of lie left in the media, which is the one thing that distinguishes what we do from, what the public relations industry does, for example, or COINTELPRO, or certain right-wing activists who use these techniques. We always reveal the falsity. Except sometimes it's so convincing, I guess we can't. But anyways, the main result of this, there were a few different results of this action, as you might imagine. And one of them was that Dow lost a bunch of money and then regained it. Another was that there were about 600 articles in the US press about Dow and Bhopal. And so it definitely was the most successful action we've done, in that it really did fulfill what we had set out to do, which was associate the word Dow with the Bhopal catastrophe. And from then on, people who knew about the Bhopal catastrophe knew that Dow was part of it and that they should take responsibility. Maybe I'll pause for questions and see if there's anything about this particular action. Usually there's some clear reactions to this. What? Did we face liability? No. No lawsuits. We've never had a lawsuit from a company. We've done this for 20 years and dozens of targets, and no company has ever sued us. It's because they see how much attention they get, even if they don't sue us. And, you know, if they did sue us, it would just be a fantastic stage for us. And that's been proven, that it works that way. McDonald's actually sued some leafleters in London, I think in, I don't know what year, maybe the late 90s. They sued people who were passing out pamphlets about how bad McDonald's hamburgers were and how bad the health effects were and the labor practices and so on and so forth. And about 10 years later, the activists won. And it was, in the process, managed to use this as an immense stage to get all this information about McDonald's out, which is the reason that McDonald's has salads on its menu, big deal. But the other result, more relevant to us, is that corporations don't attack protesters that way, who can use the media. If you know how to publicize things, and corporations think we do, they won't risk that in the court of public opinion. Even if they could in court, and they obviously could, you can sue anybody for anything, but they're too smart too. We were sued once by the US Chamber of Commerce, but it's a long story. For one thing, they're not a corporation. They're the world's largest lobbying firm. And it was sort of personal. And we tried to actually make it go to court, but 4 years after they filed the lawsuits, they dropped it. So we couldn't actually see what it was like. I mean, we were also a little nervous about it, to be honest, but yeah. No, I can tell you, yeah. It was, yeah, let's see, maybe I even have. Yeah. Well, let's see, maybe. Yeah, it's in our latest movie, The Yes Men Are Revolting. It kind of starts that movie. And it was basically, Let me mirror displays.
Just to clarify what I said earlier, it's not that I think
Mm-hmm. It seems like an odd choice to go through the NPAA and big production companies.
Hmm. I see. Well, the fact is it's a real hassle to make a movie, and it's an even worse hassle to distribute it. We did distribute our second movie, and I'm never doing that again. So, you know, at a certain point, you have to kind of make a choice of what you want to control and what you don't want to control. And what we're good at is, you know, these kind of gags and, you know, thinking also how to make that strategic within a context. And we're not really particularly good at doing all the rest of the stuff that we would have to do. So, you know, you choose your evil. We're all compromised. We all wear clothes that are made God knows where. We all transport ourselves using fuel. A lot of us eat meat. we all make bad choices, and there are no good choices for a lot of things. So you really choose your poison, and you choose your evil, and you don't worry about it too much, and you don't try to be too pure. So I'm not going to distribute another movie ever, and I don't care if the movie industry isn't perfect. I'm just going to make that choice and judge that in the sum total of it, it's worth it. And one of the reasons I think it's worth it is Occupy transition. Like when we went to Occupy, we were actually in a kind of down moment then. And when Occupy happened, it really lifted us up because a lot of people came up and said, oh, I saw your movie when I was 10 and it got me curious about this and then I turned into this. And you know, enough people told us that we felt like, oh, okay, we're just going to keep doing this because this makes sense. Even though for a while I was like, why are we doing this and what's the point? And these actions don't seem to accomplish that much by themselves. But this kind of knock-on effect, this cultural effect seems to be worth it. So I just wanted to show one last clip before we take questions. And if you have a class you have to get to or studying you have to do, please feel free to leave after this. If you want, we can stick around and talk some more. But I'll just show this last clip, which took place at Occupy. And it was our sort of way to, we had this challenge where Occupy was happening, and it was super inspiring. But what on earth do we do with our kind of activism? Because usually it's very elaborate and takes a lot of planning. And this was complete chaos. And very horizontal. So this is an action that we came up with basically on the spur of the moment. We had 20 suits from thrift stores, and that's pretty much all we had. We had some pens also. So, and we had decided we would try to do some things there that were funny and that made people laugh and that added a little levity to the whole situation, and maybe a break from the police truncheons and various difficult things that were going on. And so this is one of the little things we did. And this is from our latest movie, The Yes Men Are Revolting.
There is no
hierarchy!
Hierarchy!
Who knew that so many people felt the same way that we did?
Corporations getting money handed to them, and the CEOs making $5-6 million after they took money to bail them out. That pisses me off too, man. Come on.
Since even the cops are fed up, maybe they should join a protest.
Hey, are you using those pizza boxes to sleep on, or? Oh, okay. We want to make signs.
You want to go? Oh, that you can taste them.
Yeah.
You're done with sleeping.
Oh, okay.
Huddle, everybody. Huddle.
Okay. Huddle.
All right. So this is the deal. We are going on a broker's march. We try to get police to go with us.
We're doing a direct action!
That is highly risky!
That is highly risky!
And
irrestible!
Get the ball! 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 Get the ball!
Wall Street is our street. Wall Street is our street. Wall Street.
more police showed up to make sure we didn't cause trouble.
Is our street where the wall speech
So that was total of, wait, where's this? Oh, I wanted to show that. Yeah, this is the, there. It's the largest tabloid in New York, the Long Island Post, and no explanation of what the image meant, but but it was a lot of fun, and it took us a total of 4 hours, so shows the kind of ease that sometimes you can do these things with. And we've started workshops. This is a, let's see. This is a picture of one of our labs that we've been doing and coming up with all kinds of actions around different issues that small groups of activists are concerned with. And it's called the Yes Lab. It's at yeslab.org. And we've been doing these workshops for quite a while with varying degrees of success, but a lot of fun. And that's basically what I wanted to say, that, yeah, there's ways to use techniques of this sort for any issue that you care about. These are some of the resources that are useful if you want to try to use these techniques on your own. Actipedia.org is just tons and tons of examples that you can browse through. Let's see, I think I've put these up. And through issues and areas and so on and so forth, and get inspired. That's the main way we come up with ideas. And then there's Beautiful Trouble, which has a lot of lists of tactics and principles and theories and case studies and so on, and you can really go deep into that. There, it's a wonderful educational tool. And finally, on our website, we're redoing it, but this is going to, this is currently at actionswitchboard.net, which is one thing we've done, a platform for activism. And there's a cookbook that gives you the various secrets of what we in particular do, with all kinds of tips and techniques and some general sort of media training stuff. So feel free to browse around and contact us, and stick around if you need to go to class again or other thing, please do. But otherwise, we can keep talking. Social media is fun to play with, and we've done some really fun actions. Let's see, coalcares.org. Like, this was a website that we made for the coal industry to help them explain a solution to childhood asthma as a result of coal plants. Obviously, the answer is to make decorated inhalers so that kids wouldn't be stigmatized for having asthma. And it was so sort of convincing that the that people, and we sent out a little press release and a few tweets and stuff, and people just, you know, reacted with a huge amount of outrage, and then realized that they had been tricked, and then sent out another tweet or two, and it became this big kind of tweet thing, a social media phenomenon, and that got it into the media. So, you know, it really, you just kind of run with whatever there is. Like, it's like, yeah, in the 60s, people used to use phone trees. Oh, thank you. I was looking for that. How did you know? They used to use phone trees to organize protests. You know, one person would call five people. Each of those would call five more people. Soon you had thousands of people showing up. And it actually worked better than Facebook because you had a human voice to that you had committed to, and so it, you know, a lot more people would show up among the people who'd said yes. So you know, but Facebook permits other things like really spreading a massive amount of a bit of information to a really massive number of people immediately, and acting as a news source. So it's not better; it's just different. And same for us; it's just things keep changing. Yep.
For distribution of your film, is it purely digital or a mix between
the four? This one, the latest one, was strictly digital. It was in a few theaters, but mainly just digital, iTunes, Amazon, and all that. Now we have DVDs, but they're mainly just to pass out. Yeah. Yeah, it's changed a lot.
I was wondering if you've ever thought of also using any startups you're already established, but any website you're funding like Kickstarter?
Yeah, yeah. We used Kickstarter to fund our latest movie. I think we made a lot of money. I mean, relatively, $150,000, which is a lot, but it's not much for a movie, unfortunately. They're stupidly expensive, not to make, but to finish and to distribute and all that stuff, and to get the legal rights for. You can actually make a movie. A friend of mine just made a movie that's really good, that's full length and beautifully done for $10,000. But he has none of the rights, and he's just releasing it and in film festivals. And you know, if money isn't an issue and you don't want to try to get it, you know, distributed by a big company, then you can actually make a movie for very little money and a lot of work. Yeah.
Andy, is there anything that you see in Vermont that you think, gosh, that really needs the yes men treatment?
Huh. I'm not up on Vermont except for the obvious presidential candidate stuff.
You and the rest of the world.
Yeah. I mean, I was hearing on the radio there was some toxic chemical situation near Bennington. Yeah, I'm sure that could use, I don't know what it is, but. Oh, yeah. It's a really good thing to focus attention on. I mean, you know, the local issues, I think, are where it's at, and what it's all interconnected. Like, you can say climate change is the most important thing in the world, but all the local issues are also part of that. And you know, as long as we have this system that lets DuPont put toxic chemicals into Bennington's drinking water, we've got a system that lets oil companies keep doing what they're doing, and the food, and you know, there's ways to change the system that they all point to the changes that we need. Like all issues point to the changes that you need. So what you find locally is just as important to focus on, probably more important than the big picture stuff. Yeah.
The stuff tailing off of that, it seems like the Republican front runner just cries out for a yes man action, although I just wonder if it's too far gone for satire. You know,
it seems to do itself. Yeah, I mean, I have no idea what, you know, we tried in 2004 to use this kind of thing against Bush and failed miserably strategically with the project itself for, you know, reasons that in retrospect are pretty obvious. But it's just a, you know, I don't know, it's a bit, maybe it's out of our league or something. Like, it just feels like you need to really understand how the whole thing works. And
yeah, but just some of the statements that are being made. And
yeah.
Thinking of I remember the burger thing that you guys did.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you just took it so far that finally people had to go, wait a minute, that's not okay.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so it seems to me that with some of the statements that are being made from the podium there,
yeah,
you might be able to take it one little bit farther, but that feels dangerous at the same time.
Yeah,
you know,
it's like, yeah, what would it do? How does it work? I don't understand how the Republican frontrunner can possibly be doing well. I have no comprehension of it, so I wouldn't know how to satirize it. Like, You have to kind of understand why people like something before you, you know, and it's so complicated and weird and, yeah. But I'm sure, you know, somebody who does understand it could easily use this kind of thing to do something useful. I just don't know what that would be. Yeah?
How have you sort of, like, kept up morale around yourself often to, like, lawmaking?
Yeah, great question. How have we kept up morale when we felt we aren't making the kind of impact we want to make? That's actually what our whole third movie is about. And it's really realizing that, in short, it's realizing that even failed actions or even actions that don't seem to achieve massive change, like, for example, the Bhopal, the BBC action that we did, definitely our most successful action in terms of getting the idea across and media impact, but Dow is still doing, you know, Dow has still not compensated the survivors, and they never will. They can't. Structurally, they can't. And yet, to say that was a failure doesn't really make sense, because, you know, there's a movie and people see it and maybe they get inspired to do something. And the same can be said of entire movements like Occupy. People still say sometimes, oh, it didn't achieve anything. Because, you know, if you just look at the media cycle that covered it, well, you know, it happened, there was a lot of attention, and then they were evicted, and the media said, oh, well, they're gone. But if you look carefully, they're definitely not gone. You know, that movement is just that was just a little part of a movement. It was just one phenomenon in a movement that, you know, that got a lot of people energized. And then when Hurricane Sandy hit New York, that whole network mobilized and did a bunch of relief work. That movement is what basically got the New York mayor elected. And Bernie Sanders obviously comes out of Occupy. And so, you know, it's a movement, and it's long, and it's not going to end with Bernie Sanders getting elected or not. It's, you know, that's just one phase of it, and these things are really long. Like, if you look at the civil rights movement, it was over a long period, and similarly, you know, there were these moments when a lot was happening and then nothing, and then the networks didn't go away, they just did something else. So it takes a long time before things change, but so in a way, like, you can say actions or moments never really win, like the kinds of things that we do never actually achieve anything in a way by themselves, and no protest ever does, and no movement moment ever does, but movements as a whole always win, pretty much. I mean, it seems like I can't think of any major movement that hasn't won. You know, we don't have slavery much, or in the same way that we used to. Women have more rights than they used to. Gays have marriage. You know, on and on and on. These are all movements. Yeah?
I'm assuming that the O3 movie helped, but I'm really curious what you guys were doing to kind of, like, keep the lights on and keep food.
Oh, yeah. Right. I kept working in the computer industry for a little while, for a long time actually, for about 10 years after that. Then I started teaching at universities. So I was teaching at Parsons, the new school in New York, and then NYU for 4 years. Now I don't have a job, but and this is how I make a living. But and Mike also, he's been teaching for about 20 years now at RPI in Troy, New York. So that's how we make a living. This is sort of our work, but that's also our work. And about the movie making money, it didn't really. I mean, it made a little bit of money, but not really. And generally, independent movies don't make money. or at least not much. So you can't really live off that.
Did any money come in from, the fake websites and the news releases? I know they're not direct sources, but through, I guess, word of mouth, as you're taking your head.
Mm-mm. No, that never makes, and there's no way that, I mean, we never asked for money for that. We did ask, we did use Kickstarter type things before Kickstarter to raise money. Sometimes we would send an email to our list saying, we've got a project in the works, it's top secret, did you have a little money to make it work? And we funded a fake edition of the New York Times that way. We printed 100,000 copies of the New York Times and released it. 1 week after Obama's first victory in 2008, early 2009, that was sort of a message to the movement, actually, that it had gotten him elected. And it was a newspaper that was post-dated 6 months into the future and had all the great things that could happen if that movement kept going and kept and got more and more radical and took to the streets and applied the pressure to Obama to do the things he had promised. It worked as a project, and people contributed enough money that way to make it happen. But unfortunately, it didn't make the movement keep the pressure on.
Was that the one responsibility
that what?
Lily
Ledbetter. I don't know what that is.
First of all, that he signed to at least try to make it legal for women to have the same pay.
No, we did this right after his victory. Just counting on his victory, we prepared this paper and post-dated 6 months in the future, and then he won. And we knew that, the standard response when you get somebody elected is just to say, there, we did it. And unfortunately, that would be probably a bit of the response if Bernie Sanders got elected, but maybe less because people know better now. We probably all remember what happened with Obama, and we're probably a little more prepared to actually keep pressure on whoever wins. So hopefully that changes. One hand. Yeah.
You seem like you mostly do guerrilla satire, fake websites and such. Have you ever considered maybe starting a YouTube channel doing fake news stories like The Onion or The Bear Report?
Yeah, they do that pretty well. We focused really on this sort of thing and on kind of popularizing this sort of thing as a kind of zero budget thing you can do to kind of tap into the media. It's sort of a collaboration with the mainstream media rather than trying to be media in itself. So we do these things and hopefully get interest from the media to, either because we fool them and so it becomes a joke, or because they just find it funny and so they report on it. Like this, for example, people, the media reported on because it was funny and it got so much social media action. So, and usually these things work best when there's already a movement going and when there's already attention on an issue. Then this can add a little bit more attention. That's basically the way we work. Yep, one or two.
Mm-hmm. Is that something that you're doing with a lot of other colleges? Is that sort of a touring, the dog and pony show that you bring around?
The dog and pony show, yes. That's the dog, and this is the pony, yeah. Right. Yeah. No, that's easier. Yeah, we do workshops and just try to, different lengths. Sometimes they're very short, like today, so we just basically talked about, showed some examples and analyzed how we do these things in more detail. Sometimes they go for hours, 3 hours or 6 hours, and we've done a few that are 2 or 3 days, and then we really actually develop an action, or two or three, and get the ball rolling on them. And some actions can actually be accomplished in a day or two or three. Sometimes they take a lot longer, but we can at least get the parts in place and, you know, set up a little team and, yeah. So there's a, yeah, you can visit the yeslab.org for a whole bunch of the projects that have come out. Oh yeah, Snowden pardon, that was very quick, little easy thing. But there's a whole lot of these things going way back. So yeah, I'm browsing too fast for questions to be possible, perhaps on purpose. Yes, this and that and the other thing. Okay, so if there are no more questions, thank you very much. And it's been really amazing to be here. And I'm really appreciative for the opportunity to speak to you. Thanks.